Welcome all. I can see everyone starting to the numbers start to come in. We're going to get started in a minute or so. We'll just give you just give participants a few moments to join. The chat should be live and open, so please feel free to join in already. So to those who just joined us, we're just going to wait a few moments for everyone to come on board. I'm joining you from Denmark, from Copenhagen, which is where, of course, Rikke is as well too. So welcome to you all. Hello. So I think we should get started now as people drift in. We'll get through the introductory part. So first of all, I'm in Denmark, as is our guest Rikke, and but I would like to do an acknowledgement of country even from this distance, and I would like to acknowledge the fact that most of the time I spend my life working and living on the home of the Boonwurrung people of the Kulin Nations, and I'm very grateful for being able to do that, and I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging in this virtual space. And I can see that many Australians are putting the country that they're on in the chat, and of course I'd always welcome you to name the country on which you're working and living, and show your respects. So it gives me enormous pleasure to host this Cradle seminar. It's a very special one. We have an international guest, and I'm delighted to be separated from her by only a few hundred kilometres as opposed to thousands. And Rikke, and I've been told I have to do this with a very straight face to get the Danish accent right, which I will still mangle anyways, but I might be able to do the straight face. Rikke Toft Nørgaard is Associate Professor in Educational Design and Technology at the Danish School of Education in Aarhus University. She's a member of the steering group of the Centre of Higher Education Futures. I think the thing about Rikke's work is that it is about, and this is in her bio, but I do think it's true, the complexities, challenges and potentials of this sort of overlay of education, design, technology and philosophy, particularly as pertains to higher education. So I'm in a super exciting space, something that's incredibly relevant to us in Cradle, and I think obviously to many, many people around the world. So very excited for this talk. Now, before I pass over to Rikke, I'm going to do the housekeeping. So if you haven't been to a Cradle seminar before, what we normally do is we keep the chat chatty. So please, please, please feel free to chat to old and new friends within the chat. We don't monitor it. It will do what it needs to do. If you have a question to ask, if you want to raise a question, please go into the Q&A. We are going to leave plenty of time for discussion. There's going to be about 20 minutes for discussion. There's also going to be some interactions using Mentimeter within the seminar itself. And then, as normal practice, we'll bring the formal proceedings to close at the hour. And people who want to stay on and chat, if there's interest, we will continue on with some of the discussion. So, without further ado, let me pass over to you, Rikke.
Thank you so much, Margaret, and thank you to you and Cradle for inviting me. Let's see if everyone or someone is still excited after the seminar, but here we go. I'll try to keep track of my own time because I'm very chatty. So let's see, as I usually say, let's see where we end. That will probably be fine enough. And you'll get, if you want, all the slides. I don't think I mentioned that in your mail, Margaret, but I'm fine with giving out the slides. There's a lot of resources and links and stuff like that on them that you can access afterwards if you want to know more. So, and now I can't see anyone or the chat, which is probably nice for my focus, but, you know, Margaret, shout if there's something not working. I have the pleasure of being invited to this Cradle seminar today to talk to you a little bit about hybrid learning spaces and higher education teaching and learning beyond HyFlex. And I'll try to say a little bit about the theoretical background of the concept of hybrid and hybridity and hybridization and this strange notion of hyper-hybridity, especially because it seems to be, from my viewpoint, misinterpreted a bit sometimes, or used in different ways. That's a more gentle way to say it. And then I'll try to introduce a designerly approach to taking these concepts and creating a framework for developing or working on developing hyper-hybrid higher education. And in the end, I will showcase a little bit how we work with it throughout a whole entire master's program, both on the meso level, on the curriculum level, as a pedagogical approach, as concrete teaching and learning activities. But as Margaret also mentioned, there's some Mentimeter exercises here. I'll also share the link in the chat. But before I talk to you about, and it's not like a check and there's no right or wrong answers, but before I start to think about the notion of hybridity and hybrid, I would really, really love to hear your thoughts on this. Let's see if everything is working. So there's a Mentimeter code here at the top, and there are hopefully a link in the chat now as well. So that should be the option of like putting in three words, I think. And it's just really what springs to mind when we hear the word hybrid. What is the first we kind of think about? So just like any input would be welcome. And I'll also share this with you afterwards as kind of a collective map of our initial thoughts here, and the same with the other Mentimeter exercises. It's nice to not only have my voice, but your voice as well. And it's also nice that this voice is actually also anonymous, because you are then allowed to, you know, mean what you actually would like to say without, I don't know, getting fired or reprimanded or scolded or I don't know, whatever. As you can see, I don't know if everyone is familiar with Mentimeter, but the words that are bigger than other words are the ones that multiple people put in. So you can see there's something about blended, mixed, a mixture, a combination, dual. So I think dual is pertaining to the online on-site dimension, online, combined. But there's also like other notions like entanglement and contemporary. And then there's like both kind of bright words and more dark words, or however you would say it. So something about sharing and accessibility and experimenting. But it was also, I saw something like stressful, at least inauthentic, also kind of a dark word perhaps. But it seems to, like, reading across the words here, there seems, and Frankenstein might be bright, might be dark. There seems to be a mixture, or like what takes up the center stage here, both in the smaller words and the bigger words, is this kind of mixture of something online and something on-site, and a blend, something that is blended, like blended learning. And then the question is, of course, then what is the difference between hybrid education and blended learning? Then we need to kind of figure that out. And online, yes, but then again, what's the difference between online learning and hybrid learning? Is that because someone is on site as well and stuff like that? So so this is actually the first thing we'll try to address. And the Mentimeter here, we'll return to it. And so you can have it open in the background. And if you haven't put in your words yet, I'll also keep it open so everyone can kind of have their go. Right. But coming from the humanities, I might also add, when we read into theories on hybrid and hybridity, both kind of inside and outside education, it's actually quite far removed from this notion of hybrid as a high flex model. So you have someone online and you have someone on site receiving education at the same time. Rather, hybrid refers to new species, forms, or culture that is kind of fused or crossed between elements, parts, or other species, or a dissolution of already existing species, forms, or culture. So a hybrid such as a mule or a grapefruit or a mule here is not a donkey horse or a horse donkey, but it's something other. It's a new form. It's a form in its own right. So it's a mule. So here, I think it's important to think about that basically a hybrid is a new species, form, culture, thing, whatever we call it. Hybridization as a concept then describes the intentional process of this crossbreeding, fusing, dissolving species, forms, cultures to create new hybrids. So hybridization here is the development, design, creation of new hybrids, and it has some sort of intentionality about it. Hybridity then is a term for the relation between a hybrid and its source material. So hybridity highlights what makes a hybrid hybrid. It is kind of its otherness, its strangeness, its newness, what sets it apart from the source material or from other forms. So it's kind of its distinctiveness or its signature traits when compared to other species, forms, or cultures. So again, hybridity is the salient hybrid characteristics of the hybrid. Then hyperhybrids, which is kind of, well, I don't know if it's my term, but I'm using it at least, probably other people are. No one is really unique, I think. We sometimes think we are, but we seldom are. Might be hybrids. But hyperhybridity then, and the way I use it in education, is utilizing multiple dimensions of hybridization at once. So this is kind of an entanglement to dissolve the dichotomies or create fusions between the on-site, the online, the digital analog, the open closed, formal, informal, academic, professional, students, teachers, researchers, educators, and so on and so forth. So you have all these dimensions, and then you kind of throw some ingredients into the pot and you start to kind of stir it to see what happens, a bit like an alchemist trying to make gold, not necessarily making gold, but you are on the hunt for gold, and then other kind of interesting hybrids might happen to you along the way. So hybridization dissolves or fuses multiple hybrid dimensions at once to create these kind of hyper-hybrid being. So again, as mentioned, it's think about it a bit like being an alchemist. So you're trying to create something new, something that are capable of creating a new situation, delivering new learning potentials, a new teaching atmosphere. It can be a lot of things that you'd want to kind of pull forward by starting to mix multiple dimensions. So of course you can kind of, which is where I think most of us start, perhaps trying to experiment, tinker with one of the dimensions. So how can we create a third space between the online and the on-site by entangling these two spaces? So it's not as much like, I don't know, a lot of the practice of the HyFlex model where you have like two, it's more like parallel teaching than hybrid teaching. There's not much entanglement. There's someone in the on-site audience and there's someone in the online audience. And some might feel they are the almost like the spectators to their own education, which is not very good, I think, not especially when we think about the purpose of higher education. So feel like one step removed and spectating, looking in on their own education. When we do it good, it might be that both audience are able to participate, but often still in this parallel manner. So what qualifies something as actually being hybrid is you have to kind of fuse these dimensions. Even if it's just one dimension, like the online and the on-site, then we kind of master the art of creating hybrids. You can start to create more complicated beings, a bit like when you're starting to, a big bread. You start something simple, you have a recipe perhaps, and then you start to experiment, and suddenly you are a baker in your own right, and you have your own kind of signature bread or something like that. A bit the same here. So you can start by focusing on creating new hybrids between, by dissolving or connecting or entangling online, on-site dimensions in new ways. And then, as we did in the masters, start to add on. So, okay, how can we think differently about when students are in the open or in the closed? So we had like exams at public libraries. We have had like exams in the form of student conferences to create like these kind of formal situations in the open. Creates a, really takes a lot of ethical effort on the teacher, of course, and on the system. We try to kind of create new blends between academic life and work life, and what is life when you are in higher education and what is life when you are working, and so on and so forth. So again, I think the core message here is that hybridity or hybrid does not necessarily have anything to do with blended learning or high flex models or flipped classroom, which is often kind of thought of as sequential. So you have something on site, and then we do something online, and then we do something on site, and then we do something online. Or we have these parallel tracks. That, however, does not mean that it cannot kind of look the same on the surface level. So of course you cannot have everything happening at once, but what you are after is not a sequence. What you are after is kind of an experience or the whole interaction, something, again, that is entangled, even though there is a process or a sequence. Don't know if that makes sense. We can discuss it afterwards, perhaps. Thinking, looking a bit into the literature, perhaps especially before the pandemic, we can see this kind of notion is actually quite normal in the literature, also within higher education and education. So again, here, instance, and Dumont talks about hybridity as something that promotes a horizontal connectedness across activities and subjects inside and outside the formal learning environment. And there's this hybrid entanglement, there's integrated and merged connections, and Sisser and Hove in their report on hybrid learning environments from 2012 talk about that in contrast to contemporary forms of workplace simulations, work integrated learning and so on, hybrid learning environment seeks to integrate and merge learning and working. So again, how do we fuse and entangle dimensions rather than keep them apart or in a sequence? Another take on this, which is, well, during the pandemic, is the report from European University Association called the Universities Without Walls, a vision for 2030. In general, I think it's quite nice and a surprisingly nice read. And there are sections that really talks to this vision of, or this notion of hybridity. So in the report, they talk about when looking to the future, we envision universities without walls. These are universities that are open and engaged in society while retaining their core values. So again, we need to create a new hybrid here, or a new hybrid model for the university. They will provide open, transformative space for common knowledge production through research, education, innovation, and culture, together with other societal stakeholders, and so on and so forth. So again, this kind of new entanglement, entangled understanding of the university and higher education, actively involving citizen and non-academic partners, being cooperative and networked institutions or hybrid institutions, locally, nationally, internationally. So again, this kind of entanglement. And well, and then of course, they say also the nature and structure of universities will be hybrid. Of course, they talk about this physical, digital or online on-site, but they also talk about it as something more. It must be designed in a holistic way to accommodate the different needs of diverse university community and allow for flexible blended approaches. Don't really like the mixture of words here, but again, explore new innovative ways of pursuing in university's mission. So again, how can we think differently? How can we create something other, or something that has an otherness or hybridity or a hybrid to help move towards this vision? So again, moving from this kind of very theoretical or abstract level to a bit more concrete. I'm not the best at being concrete, but design principles, let's call it that. So how do we then think when we go into this kind of alchemist mode and start to try to pull forward a new kind of teaching activity, a new learning experience, set up a new learning space, and so on and so forth. So one thing is to focus on what is called kind of heterotopic places. So places where a lot of different things can happen at once, rather than trying to kind of create a transparent uniform structure, then try to create these bit more messy places. So we can have these hybrid knowledge form where we can think and talk and collaborate and exchange ideas together. Often we have a tendency, both in high flex models, but also other models, to wall off the students so they can't really interact with each other. They can't really bother the teachers too much and so on and so forth. They are more kind of put on a track, a bit like an advanced letter course, and then they can kind of receive education. And again, that doesn't really work when you talk about hybrid education, where we have to go for this fusion of parts and entanglement structures. The other thing is, and I think this is probably the most important point, is to work intentionally to kind of dissolve traditional dichotomies through hybridization. So again, why are we making this hybrid activity or this hybrid module or this hybrid education or this hybrid institution, depending on your level of work here? What are the dichotomies we are trying to dissolve or decompose? What are the new, what are the existing elements, ingredients that we are trying to fuse into something new? And what are we after? What is the value? What is the experience? And what is the interactions that we want to see and recognize as something brought about by this hybrid? Thirdly, and this really connects to what I just talked about, is to have this value sensitive in a pedagogical, didactic, educational way, approach to hybridization. So again, looking into the theories on hybrid education and hybrid cultures and hybrids in general, they are really about creating new types of cultures, new types of experiences, new types of interactions that really focuses on mutual care, belonging, feeling that you are part of something that you wasn't able to be part of before, or be part of something in a new way that allows you to do new things and so forth. So again, also thinking about the climate and all the crap we put into the world, if we are to create a new hybrid, why is this hybrid needed in a certain way? What is its worth? What is its value? Fourth, and that again connects to what we just talked about, we need to create hybrid communities for them to be a culture, for them to be a hybrid in this entanglement sense. It has to have some breadth and depth. So again, I think is it Papert that has this notion of wide walls, low floors, high ceilings? That really also goes for the hybrid community collaboration or communication we are trying to enable by putting something forward as a teaching activity, as a course design, and so on and so forth. Are there low floors? Can everyone enter on their own terms? Or do they demand too much? Have they kind of white walls? That's again the heterotopic notion. Are they allowing for multiple types of communication, collaboration, and community that again creates new hybrids and has this kind of ecosystem approach? And do they have high ceilings? Are you allowed to do more than what is minimally required in this activity or situation? Can you strive to excel in a certain way? And again, that points towards hyper-hybrid universities existing in and as these ecosystems. So we are kind of tinkering with the universe in a certain kind. We are trying to create a new ecosystem where new life forms can kind of exist, new learning activities, new ways of thinking, new ways for students to communicate, or have new ways of reaching out and accessing the surrounding ecosystems, the online world, the on-site world, the workplace, the society, and the parents, whatever, and new ways for the world to seep into education by bringing education out into the open. As we tried, we had our courses, just posted the link to whenever we were teaching on Twitter and say, oh, if anyone wants to come and hear a bit about the digital media history, you know, you can just join the course and come on in. And sometimes people came in and it was just teaching going on. Sometimes they left again, but again, it was open because in Denmark, at least, higher education is actually open and public. No one ever comes. This again is this kind of trying to create a lively place, reintegrating our humanity in these hybrid educations. So hybrids are really lively creatures, lively cultures. They are cultures that are not set in stone. They are still kind of simmering. They're still new. And this kind of spirited, lively atmosphere is also important to try to preserve when we think about hybrids in higher education. So we can kind of go beyond this HyFlex campus. I'm jumping a bit. I'm keeping my eye on time here. So again, thinking about this, it's really about trying to move from the current digitalization of higher education or automatization of higher education or HyFlex models that are one ring to rule them all and can be kind of implemented across in uniform ways, across disciplines, institutions, whatever, to this kind of more hybrid futures and kind of reconnecting with the deeper purposes of higher education, which is something way more strange and disturbing and have kind of really honing in on students as belonging to an academic community and an academic life world, together with teachers and the institution itself, and developing themselves as academics in a lot of different ways through participating continuously in many different forms of communication, collaboration, co-creation, and community events. And again, thinking about hybrid education, as we just talked about it in the beginning, where we created the word cloud, the question is this really how we think about hybrid higher education? Are we thinking about it in the right way, so to speak? So again, summing up here, and then, you know, I'll let you play a bit again. It's really thinking about hybrid universities as holistic, ethical, open ecosystems. So they need to be systems worth living in. They need to be systems worth learning in. They need to be systems worth teaching in. Otherwise, why do we have them? So we must really make sure that when we create a hybrid activity, a hybrid module, a hybrid institution, whatever we are talking about here, that they are not kind of sinister or cold-hearted hybrids, but kind-hearted hybrids honoring the purpose of the university or higher education. So over to you a bit here. This is just kind of my rant, but I would be kind of really interested in, and then I'll just change here, what would be an important principle for you when you think about it for creating valuable hybrid or just hybrid higher education? Because I think it's also really different across the disciplines. I think it's really different from different kind of institutional perspectives. And this is just one way of kind of thinking about hybrid higher education. So there's something at least about the equity and inclusivity. And so again, yes, but how do we embed this as a design principle would be my next question. So these are really clear values, but again, how do we practice them in ways that kind of really aim for hybridization, that are kind of a way of creating hybrid designs in this kind of broad sense that are inclusive in and of themselves? So of course, not everyone knows, but we know a lot about inclusive teaching and teaching for community, teaching in democratic ways, accessible ways. But when we think about these new beasts, then we need to think about new ways of understanding inclusion, perhaps also new ways of creating communities that might feel strange again if they're just the same. Why are we making them and not just doing as we are already doing? And if they are really different, what is engagement then? What is democracy? What is it to be appealing? I really like this. What is the critical use of technologies? How do we enable that in hybrid ways? So I think that's really, and I'm also getting all sweaty with excitement now. That's what really excites me, is how can we do this in ways that might even seem revolting to people in the beginning, institutional leaders or teachers, and how might we kind of, again, like an alchemist, really trying to tinker and think that's actually what makes educational design and teaching really exciting, is to listen to what is happening when we are trying to create these hybrids. What is it that comes to the fore? It might be something that is really not a good idea, and it might be something that has a great potential. So it also it requires of me as a teacher to really be in contact with my students and the system and the institution and my research foundation in education when I'm tinkering, also when I'm tinkering together with other teachers, or ask other teachers to tinker, or even ask students to tinker, or and so on and so forth. Last leg of this before we kind of open the floor, and I'm really interested in what you think here. Again, keep the nice thinking flowing here, and again I'll share it in the end, of course. See if everything works. So the last thing I kind of I promised was to be a bit more concrete in the end. And I'll try to do this in the last 5-6 minutes of my presentation here. So at Aarhus University, we have a master's that we've been practicing or experimenting with, I think is the right term here, since 2013, to try to first create a hybrid higher education master's, and then hyper-hybrid higher education master's. And so it's one of the only masters at Aarhus University that has online modules at all. Aarhus University is really an on-site university. I think that goes for most universities in Denmark. So just the idea of creating this entanglement or this third space between the online and the on-site format was quite revolting and disturbing to Aarhus University in the beginning. And then way later on, the pandemic happened, and suddenly they were really happy that someone had some experience to share. Then also thinking about how to then entangle the digital and analog forms of teaching and learning with the online, with each other, and with the online and on-site. So often, for example, again, to be concrete, when we teach, we use the surrounding space and ask people about ask our students to take us on tour in their homes, or drag a paper, drawn paper, and show it, or take a picture and share it, and then or print something and draw on it, just like a really basic thing here. So the dichotomy between something digital and ephemeral and something physical and material kind of dissolves. So we come into this kind of post-digital understanding of education, which is on the other side, rangsiden, on the other side of how we often think about education. Then we really work with formal and informal learning spaces. So sometimes we also teach and eat, or teach and walk, again, online walks perhaps, teach with kids and stuff like that, which is really transgressive to the professional being a teacher, but it makes me very human or makes the students very human. And it can, again, it's a very basic example here. We are also doing it very, very advanced ways. And then this entanglement of the individual, the group, and the collective is really, really important when we think about educations that are partly also partly online, also partly digital. How do we sense each other? How do we almost smell each other? How do we feel each other? How do we reach out into the screens and touch each other? As a group, how do we create group thinking? How do we create a collective being so we are not just on our own tracks here? The first move as a collective, so again, we are also a group of scholars here, all working with hybrid education or hybridity in youth education or whatever. So it's also, of course, our field. And then this master and poor students are really the melting pot for how to move this agenda forward, and learn more and more and more over the years. So where we started was to, I think that's an important place to start, is to identify some values we would like to hybridize and then create hybrid formats for. So these around here are the identified core values for the masters, and then we try to start tinkering with them. So how can we have a hybrid community where students are at the same time mothers, fathers, siblings, students, someone with a job, someone with a growing profession, someone that has passions and hobbies and so on, and how can we draw on all that to create a deeper, broader community, for example? How can students, even during their education, go and participate in society as citizens and contribute with real knowledge, contribute with projects and products and so forth and so on, so to just take one dimension. Then the next move was to take these values and ideas, core being implicit curriculum, and create a deep pedagogy, a deep practice for it. So we tried to kind of hybridize the spaces by a bit like kneading, is it called that, when you do this with the bread, kneading the bread and taking in more and more dimensions and until they kind of dissolve because it stopped making sense, a bit like the gender discussion. Perhaps now there are so many genders that perhaps someday we can just be humans or something like that. A bit the same approach here. Let's keep on complicating the space until we just have a place to be. A bit the same approach with activities. How can we blend them continuously so that we are more focusing on the activity rather than if it's synchronous or asynchronous or online or on-site and so forth? What it's really about is the dialogue. What it's really about is the workshop. What it's really about is a new form of expressing yourself into an online academic community or something like that. And again, with the products, the final products, so we're really trying to invite the students to create materializations of their thinking and deliver that to societies, workplaces, back into their professional context, to each other, to teachers, and so on and so forth. So they engage in higher education in new ways, in hybrid ways, where academic thinking might take on new forms. Finally, I'm just going like this. Where we are at the moment is then thinking about how to transform these values, these activities, this thinking into a whole curriculum, digital curriculum, and how do we preserve hybrid curriculum? I would probably say we have different terms here in our teaching team. How do we have clear pedagogical principles? How do we entangle clear technological possibilities like these to create new form of hybrid digital competencies where we can participate in education with each other, in the world, with the world, for the world, in new ways, produce academic thinking, academic practice in new ways that can take on new forms? And how can we create this kind of broad and deep academic networking identity, being, but also community belonging? So I think that's where we are at the moment. We have to be finished with this work come Christmas. So it's really, really in process. Last slide before I'll just say I have a lot of references here if you want to access them, and I'll share the slides. But last slide or thinking piece from me is to think about this is all really nice reggae, and this sound kind of bright and or really dark. But how does the current landscape look to you when considering the higher education value and hybrid transformational impact of current integration of educational technologies or practices in higher education? So we'll return to the Mentimeter here in the end one last time. So you should have some sliders here so you can say, oh, it has a high education value or a low higher education value. So technologies for communication in higher education, are we using, to your knowledge or in your institution, are we using them in ways that are highly hybrid or have low hybridity, have high higher education value or actually low higher education value? Technologies for sharing with each other in higher education, do we use them in highly hybrid ways or do they actually have low hybridity? Do they have high value for higher education, pedagogical value, whatever your language is here? Or are we actually using them in ways that lower the higher education value compared to traditional ways of teaching? Because then we really should stop doing that, I would say. Technologies for collaborating, technologies for asking students to produce something or present something, technologies for creating these academic communities and networks. So every time someone puts something in here, it should shuffle a bit around. The core is low, to the middle, not really matter. And when we are in the outer ring, it really matters, either in a kind of crappy way or in a very promising way. I can see that the hybridity is a bit more unsure, but actually you think so far, the seven of you that have submitted this, think that it has some value, which is nice, I think. So again, yeah, technologies for communication, allowing students to communicate with each other and the teacher, sharing stuff out either in the open, in the world, or with each other, or with the teacher, for collaborating together, or with the teacher, or with the surrounding communities, for producing something or presenting something in education or outside education, and for creating these academic communities and networks. And I can see it's actually quite stable, which is a good sign, because then we are there's actually some agreements here, and I can see it's lifting itself, it's lifting its spirit a bit up towards the hybridity, that we are actually on our way to try and be a bit more alchemistic. I don't know if that's a word, alchemistic, and tinkering and experimenting and listening to what comes back on the other side. I don't even know if we are on the other side of the pandemic yet, but reaching hopefully the other side of the pandemic. In Denmark, we have kind of almost forgotten. Yes, I will leave this so you can kind of keep on voting. I'll share, of course, the results along with the slides and the resources with you. But I'm also very mindful of time, so I would also like to allow you to have some questions or comments or revolts. And again, as Margaret mentioned in the beginning, I'll stay behind if anyone wants to extend the dialogue. But for now, I think I'll stop sharing and then let's see what happens. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Rika. That was fantastic. And you can, the chat has certainly been going crazy, and actually the Q&A has also had large numbers of questions. I mean, I love these ideas. I love the ways of thinking about hybridity as a form of entanglement, as what we can gain, and also this sort of idea of practicing it kind of as a core way of being in education and as a means of bringing things together. So many wonderful ideas. Let us just go to the questions. I'm just going to pose them to you from the upvoting. So the first question we have is from Anonymous. Hyper-hybridity, aren't we already doing this, i.e. mixing the formal, informal, work and play, campus and society? So with this term, hyper-hybridity, what are the essential elements? What makes something hyper-hybrid as opposed to garden variety hybrid, I suppose?
Yeah, I think I still need to write that article, first of all. So it's really something that, like, the definition I put on the slide today is the first time I've actually submitted to a definition. So it might really change soon. But I think we need to create a clearer language, which is, of course, a bit funny because I talk so much about complexity and entanglement, but we need to have some clear distinctions and a clearer language about what we are aiming for or intending to do. So again, I think high flex is actually a nice word. Like, it's quite clear what we mean by the high flex model, to me at least, if we mean the high flex model. So
we had a question in the chat asking what the high flex model was. So perhaps you could.
Yeah. So again, in my understanding, it's when you have a flexibility, that's the flex part, and hybrid. So hybrid flexibility, I think that's the high flex contraction. And at Aarhus University, at least how we use it there, is you have some of the students are online, some of the students are on-site, and then they receive the same teaching either usually by a teacher that are on-site with the on-site students, and then is streamed to the online students. So this is this kind of parallel teaching I'm talking about. And I think that's the, even though the model is quite simple, I think that's the most demanding model to make work well. Then we have hybrid education, and often that would be going for this kind of new species by taking one, maximum two dimensions in these dimensions I mentioned, and merge in new ways to create a new opportunity for collaborating with society, or creating a new opportunity for producing something or receiving teaching or something like that. And then hyper-hybridity, I think, is this new word that I'm testing, test driving at the moment to see, because our experiences of the pandemic and our a lot of connection with the field of digital, online, hybrid education that suddenly was worth something to the general world, actually had the kind of burst of complexity. So I think to keep the things apart, we actually need this hyper-hybridity notion for when we are putting a lot of ingredients in the pot, or trying to create something that is really complex in a certain way. Also, to not scare teachers that are new to the field or institutions that are new to the field too much, because sometimes when I talk about hybrid education, I'm really talking about hyper-hybrid education, and it's really, really complicated both to students, teachers, institutions, and systems.
That leads perfectly to the next question, which was again talked about a bit in the chat. How do we support teachers' readiness for this development?
Yes, that's a question. That's an excellent question, and it's a question I get all the time. Again, because I don't know, at least a lot of the response I get is this is really nice, Rikke, but how do I start? Or this is really nice, but this sounds crazy complicated. I'm just trying to survive. Or be ready, or I don't know, start a breakout room. So again, I think that's where we need to have this scaling vocabulary, and we might need something that is even below hybrid education. I don't know, but starting small, I would say, starting to get ready in by tinkering with one dimension, managing to hybridize one dimension, like experimenting with being online and on-site on the same time, or opening up or going out at the same time or something like that. And then really listening to what happens. Like, always, I'm almost evaluate every time I do something. I ask a student, so what do you think? What did you feel? Did this make sense? Did this make semi-sense? It's a term I often use, because so often it doesn't make totally sense, but if it makes semi-sense, then we are on the right track, right? And the same for teachers, like, try this, but it requires that you listen, and it requires that you are open to having teaching that looks way more messy and chaotic. And so so readiness is not so much about technological readiness here as it is almost about kind of professional readiness. Am I ready to start to become this kind of alchemist as an institution, or educational designer or teacher, because we really, really have a high control gene or anxiety as higher education system. And I think that's also really problematic, because that's also one of the reasons we get these really damaging systems sometimes.
There's a question that runs alongside this, but is sort of a little bit more precise. So Australian tertiary institutions are slowly recovering from COVID pandemic. Many students are indicating a preference for flexibility in the way courses are delivered and structured. You know, I think very much that high flex model. And academics are facing their own challenges in designing and delivering. What do you think the key skills are? So you've just spoken about kind of the orientation towards and the playing within a tiny, tiny dimension. What do you think people need to have to get started, I suppose?
Well, I think there's some requirements put towards the institution, actually, and now I'm talking to the institutions I know, of course, but towards the institutions and their way of thinking about education and systems and technology use to be really practical. So one of the interesting things we saw across the educational sector in Denmark, like way from kindergarten to further education, was this kind of governmental and institutional panic that was like, we don't care, you know, do something that makes sense, just make sure there's some sort of education, right? And of course, that was really hard for teachers, institutions that didn't really have any experience, but there was also a lot of freedom there, and there was a lot of reconnecting with the pedagogical purpose of that educational system. And so, of course, we see all of this shutting down again because there's like GDPR issues and there's like all sorts of things that we need to make sure is okay. But that kind of hard work from the institution to enable a broad array of crazy or strange technologies, and the reason I use these words are they don't always make sense to the IT department or to the institution. Like, why do you want this? We have this, or we have a Blackboard, this and that. Why do you want a WordPress block or something like that? And that's because they can't really see the hybrid potentials of having a WordPress block outside the institutional platforms in the open, communicating with the world, and everyone has access. Or we need to protect the students. But at least in higher education, we are all grown-ups in a way. I don't know. I never grew up, but kind of bigger people at least. And so we should also, part of that higher education, also preparing people for participating in society in these really hybrid ways. So I think openness to things you don't understand and being curious. Another thing from the pandemic was really recognizing the humanity of academics in a broad sense, also students, like, oh, you are also a mom with at-home kids or the students. Oh, you're sick. Yeah, we'll try to make sure you can participate in education in some way or form. And now we just want to shut all that down and say, what, you should go to the campus. But can't you record it if I'm sick or I have like a job interview or I'm in an internship? No, because no. At least that's kind of the response from our institution at the moment, because they really want to have students come back on the campus. They really want everyone back on the campus, but they really don't know why. And I think that's a big problem. And I think that's where hybridity becomes really important, because if we can learn anything from the pandemic, often I say we can't learn anything from the pandemic, but if there is anything to learn, I think it's this kind of seeing the complexity in a certain way and being open to the complexity. Yeah.
Seeing the complexity and being open to the complexity. I think these are fantastic prompts for our for our education systems. I think we've got time to squeeze in one more question before I close down the formal session, and then we'll move to the. You have, by the way, 32 questions in the Q&A.
Well, I have always very long, complicated answers. I can't do
No, it's fantastic. I think complexity needs complexity. This is a question from David Bowd. There is a long history of new forms and idealizations of university courses. Many lasted for a short time in few contexts, but very few survived. Are there new factors that will sustain hyper-hybridization approaches within existing universities, or will they need to die, existing universities, and be replaced by quite different institutions?
I think I can have a semi-short answer that makes semi-sense. And then I think that's actually a whole other presentation, because that's my core field as a higher education philosopher and a researcher. But when I was younger and more angry, I would say the old models of the university, the ivory tower or whatever, needed to die for this to really blossom. But again, if we think of this notion of hyper-hybridity, it kind of goes all the way. So there's this notion of mode one, two, and three higher education institutions. So mode one is the ivory tower. The mode two is the competence factory, where we just try to do what society tells us. And then the mode three, which is really this kind of hybrid notion that I'm also talking about, the institutional model lying somewhere in wait in what I'm talking about here. And so I can see no need for eradicating the ivory tower over across all institutions. Like, I think sometimes we need a bit of a meditative space as an institution, or in our teaching, or in our module, where we really retract. There's a tendency for all this active learning and showcasing everything with like producing a lot of crap. I'm saying that because I do design courses, so we produce a lot of crap in my courses as well. Sometimes we need to retract to the tower and just take some time to think, really think about what we want and why we would want that. Then go and, you know, gain some competencies. But then this mode three thing is really allowing, rather than battling, other models. Like, I know it sounds a little bit hippie-like, but, you know, allowing other kinds of beings and other kinds of species also on the institutional level, rather than one, the winner takes it all kind of attitude. And again, I might not be the biggest fan of behavioristic approaches to education or teaching, but I think there's a reason that they are there and they have some merit, and I would be really interested in learning more about that and perhaps having some, I'm just trying to say thing most foreign to me here, having some conjuring the power of behaviorism and using it for something good. And I think that's the core message of hyper-hybridity, that, oh, let's the heterotopic space, there's room for real diversity and not fake diversity. There's room for real inclusion of models and different ways of being a student, different ways of teaching, different ways of being an institution all at once. And that's, again, rather complex, of course.
Fantastic. But what a beautiful note to end on. So I'll draw to a close this formal session. Then we've got the 28 remaining questions to talk about, if we wish to, or if we have time. So first of all, thank you so much, Rege, for your wonderful talk. It's so stimulating. It's so great to have these ideas in a space that is often, I think, doesn't ask enough about what it means in a sort of fundamental sense to bring different modes together. We get caught on the technology, we get caught on the pedagogy, but this is something sort of deeper and I think really should be sparking, and I can see from the chat and from the responses, should be sparking excitement to us all. So if people need to go now, they can. I'd just like to remind you of some more Cradle events before we return back to the questions. We have the International Research Symposium Challenging Cheating, a really big example of hybridity, I think, if ever there was one, where we really are going to tease the notion of cheating apart, this notion of sort of fundamental to the institution. We've got a keynote presentation on the 12th of October at 10 a.m. by Dr. Sarah Eaton from the University of Calgary, Academic Integrity as a Transdisciplinary Field, another hybrid word, of research policy and practice. And on the 18th of October at 3 p.m, we have an interactive panel with Professor Bruce McFarlane, he of the Islands of Academia, which is, again, something that could be brought together from the Education University of Hong Kong, Professor Jeannie Patterson from the University of Melbourne, Dr. Vicky Nagy from the University of Tasmania, and our own Cradle Zone, Phil Dawson. And the next one, aside from those, next to come up after that is Jan MacArthur, who will be in Melbourne from Lancaster University, and it will actually be in person for a change. Of course, we will always stream and so forth, but we will actually be meeting, and that promises also to be exciting. So thank you all. I can see many people have more of a chance to think about them now. I'm pondering the implications that hybridity sets for accessibility. For example, in policy and practice, disability accessibility in higher ed is often divided into silos such as digital accessibility and physical accessibility. What are your thoughts about how to think about accessibility in hyper-hybrid learning spaces?
Sorry, Margaret, I think I lagged a bit or you lagged a bit, but there was something about accessibility in hyper-hybrid education, yeah.
I was lagging. So disability accessibility in higher ed is often divided into silos such as digital accessibility and physical accessibility. What are your thoughts about how to think about accessibility in a hyper-hybrid learning space?
Technical accessibility and, I don't know, human accessibility, I don't know. But of course, something like being able to actually read the screen, like I also do web... or my students also do websites. And then we have some discussions about when you, it might look very beautiful, but you're not really able to read it if you have like a color blindness or something like that. Or it's very nice, but if you have any disabilities, you won't be able to toggle the interface, or can you get the text read out loud? And the reason I'm saying this is, this is of course a judgment, but I don't think Danish higher education institutions and the researchers are the right people to ask this question to. I think we are really lacking here. When I look around in the world, like, I don't know, UK, Australia, otherwise they are light years ahead. So I would actually, and I know this is a crappy answer, and also for me because I love to talk, but I think I actually don't have a good answer here. I think that is really for other people, researchers, humans, in the broadest sense of that word, to educate us about at the moment. We are here at Aarhus University last year had our first gender discussion. So that's, you know, something people have been discussing for some times, like careers and Me Too and stuff like that. And we have a diversity council, but that's really only about gender, and we are slowly starting to ask the question, might diversity be more than gender? And that's where we are at the moment. So I'm really not the right person to ask that. I'm just like slightly embarrassed, I think.
Well, so that leaves you some room to move, and I think I look forward to that conversation. I think it would be a really interesting one. So perhaps moving to a space where you might feel a little bit more comfortable, from Jenny Piscina, I'm curious about the notion of space in hyper-hybridity. What does it mean to be present in different dimensions? How do interactions and activities emerge?
Yes, I'm more comfortable there also because I've read some theory, philosophies on place, space, and the distinction between the two. And so it's something I've worked with in the past, not necessarily in the philosophical approach to hybridity or theoretical approach, but both on kind of on-site institutions and online learning spaces. So just thinking about when we call something a place and when we call something a space, rum or sted in Danish, has ramifications of how we design for this or how we practice this. There's a one of my I have a book coming up with Ronald Barnett and Søren Bengtsen on culture in the university, and there I have a chapter on space and place, but also a chapter on atmospheric design. And I think what hybridity also, or my notion of hyperhybridity also invites for, is thinking about places rather than spaces. Also, when we think about the digital elements and the online elements, and thinking about something like Genuis Loki, the love of place, like when you fall in love with certain kind of places, it can be like childhood memories, but it can also be the spirit of that place. So Genuis Loki is the spirit of place and the love for a place, and topophilia, the love for place, sorry, and Genuis Loki, the spirit of place. And I think these are important things to start to think about, because if you think about the both kind of in our on-site and online and digital and whatever elements, but students and teachers have a, you know, if there's a good atmosphere and we can create that with add-ons like materials or the way we use our body on the screen or our voice, or everything is part of the atmospheric design to transform something from a space to a place. I think the design principle I mentioned in my presentation really pushed towards thinking about places like the ecosystem, the heterotopic places, the home, belonging and being. I think inclusivity and diversity also requires something to be a place rather than a space, and so on and so forth. The hybridization of the online and the on-site is also creating this notion of the third place in a certain way, something where we are in both places at once, and then a new place come forth. And I think that's quite important to think about. I think that's something we do not, again, I'm speaking from experience here, do not think enough about when we create, when we talk about learning environments. We are not really talking about environments. We are talking about, I don't know, a circuit board or a system or a spatial layout in a certain way. We're not talking about an ecosystem or a biosphere or a place or where we can live, where we have a home and a house. As academic, I'm talking metaphorically here, of course, but where we can live and where we don't feel like brains on a stick, but actually have a body and emotions and are full beings and stuff like that. I think that that needs to be part of our designs, because again, there's this Danish term called Dannelse or Bildung in German. Pedagogical formation, I think, is one of the closest English terms to be formed as a human being. And of course we do that, it's a very central term in primary education and secondary education. But then there's this idea that we are fully formed when we enter higher education and we don't need to take care of Bildung or Dannelse anymore. But we are not fully formed as human beings being citizens and taking care of the world and taking care of each other and figuring out who we want to be as professional beings or as academic beings. And that requires a place where we can belong and where we can grow and develop and so on and so forth. I think we do not nurture that enough anywhere in our educational system. But that's kind of more along my tangent of like doing higher education philosophy. So you can go and read the really strange things that I wrote there if you're interested.
What I really like about the whole talk and the notion is it really is kind of a radical form of holism. You know, it's bringing things together, not pushing them apart. The things that bring together, not the things that pull apart. And the next question actually asks another point of, I guess, and comes a little bit to your question about your mulling about the ivory tower. The question is, where do student preferences come into this, and who holds the power to decide what the 2030 uni will look like? And I think these are interesting questions, because sometimes what it comes to your point about behaviorism, sometimes what people want is very simple. It's not hybrid. It's within the bounds. So how do we take account of the student and what they might be wanting or aspiring to?
That's a good question. I think sometimes students want the same as we do, like having some candy and watch some Netflix and don't be bothered, you know. Mm. I also want that sometimes as a researcher and as a teacher, you know, really, and some sleep. So it actually requires, so there's this Danish philosopher called Løgstrup, who talks about the ethical demand, which also goes for teachers and institutions, which is that the moment a student enters into teaching or into education, we, institutions, teachers, whoever, we are responsible for that being. We have entered like an ethical bond with that person. So what the student wants is also my responsibility, meaning that I need to work with them in an ethical way, not in a persuasive design way, in an ethical way to enter into a dialogue about the purpose of higher education. Like, why are we here? Why are you here? Why are we here? Why am I here? What do we want together beyond watching Netflix and sleeping? What, you know, and kind of sometimes rekindle that passion for actually learning. That's this difference between assessment moment and learning moments. And students are so preoccupied with the assessment moments and the exam and the their future work life and so on that they totally forget the purpose of higher education. So we need to reconnect them to that so they actually start to care again and care for each other's learning and care for their own learning and not only for their assessment moment. And that can take some time and that requires some negotiation and that requires some frustration and, you know, a continued dialogue. So I become frustrated when I teach these kind of hybrid things where we also try to create a, I wrote an article called Participatory Academic Communities and an article called Teaching-Based Research. And both of these articles were done with the students and it was about their education or their master's. So that's also a way of negotiating it, actually allowing their voices into a bright research article, student surveys in a more radical way. So often we have like anonymous Mentimeters and stuff like that after every hour, put the things you like the most and the thing you dislike the most. How worthwhile was this to you? What would make it more worthwhile? And asking the right questions so we get the right answers, not necessarily the answers we want to hear, but answers that express the purpose of higher education. How can we dig deeper here? How can we go further? How can we, what's it like the Buzz Lightyear thing, to infinity and beyond? How do we do that together with that little time we have together, like one module, for example? And when it succeeds, the students kind of take over. It's also, again, I think this hybrid model where we talk about the human dimensions now between researcher and students. Can students do research or should they learn first? Should students be professional or can they allow to be human and feel stuff and revolts and stuff like that? And does that damage my profession? All of these things are what actually happens when we try or when we create this hybridity, because we create a place, we create a home, they start to believe they belong and have a voice and are entitled to having an opinion and engage the purpose of higher education. And that also requires the kind of revolt against the teachers in the Pink Floyd way and in the Rage Against the Machine way, to kind of quote two musical groups that I really talk to my students about. And so all this kind of builds up to a way where you actually simultaneously lose control over the students as a system or institution, as a teacher, but then become part of their community. And I think that's kind of the bigger purpose of higher education and to create these kind of academic communities rather than this notion of dishing out knowledge to students and telling them how they should think and what they should learn to be educated.
I'm really struck that that's a whole of institution project, that it is something that is best tackled all together rather than in pockets. And there's something for me in there that you're talking about our own living with the discomfort. We need to be able to live with that because we're asking our students to do that. And yet we struggle in that space as well too. I'm mindful of time, and I've looked at some of the earlier questions, and I feel that they have been mostly answered. So I'm skipping through to questions that I think are perhaps a little less discussed. So here there's sort of two questions here that are quite concrete, but I think they might be quite interesting. So talk about how applicable is hyper-hybridity in a hands-on skills-based course? So this is coming a little bit back to that purpose, but like in a very specific sense. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Again, I think that's a very good question, because at least when we look into the theories of hybridity and hybrid, and also think about Schellhoff and Hoewe's hybrid learning environments that actually talked about the entanglement of study spaces and workplaces in a certain way. That doesn't have anything to do with the digital dimension or the online dimension. And I think that's really important, that this notion is an approach to these dimensions, but they well go beyond them in a certain way, a bit like the notion of post-digital education, I think, trying to reach something else. So one of the formats that we really, really practice also in the hybrid masters are to, for example, take education to the public library and do public events there, and also sometimes the exams there. So that's a hybrid dimension. You take something that is the most sensitive, most formal part of higher education and bring it into the public space and invite friends and families, and it's in the open of the public library, so someone goes by with a stroller with an infant that is crying, and then some elderly people walks by and they're like, what the hell is happening here? Mm-hmm. Well, it's a university happening here. Also, again, to open the academic community and show how education looks. It's not something that is deeply irrelevant. It's something that is unfolding all the time. It can also be to make something like digital design that I've also been teaching very, very material, like building technologies into Lego bricks, then co-creating them into a movie, like in a digital, bringing it down to, I don't know, printing out the movie and dancing on top of it. Now I'm just making stuff up, right? But again, hybridity and hyper-hybridity has nothing and everything to do with the online and digital, understood as it's something that is an approach to reimagining, reconfiguring, reinvigorating higher education and trying to reconnect it to kind of the deeper purpose, but in a radical new way.
And so I'm just going to segue into, again, another concrete question, which kind of comes to an implementation question. The proliferation of platforms is a genuine problem in terms of digital literacy, cognitive load, and locating learning. And whether you're talking about hybridity as a digital or not, and the question goes on to say, do you see this as a challenge for someone else's answer for both teachers and students? I think my read of this is, yes, it is a challenge, but one we need to embrace. But the question, I guess, is that there is a, so both in the digital and non-digital world, whenever you bring stuff together, whenever you hybridize, you're really asking a lot of people in terms of just the simple logistics of what you're doing. How do you see that being resolvable?
Yeah, I don't think it's resolvable. I think it's something we have to learn to live with like the complexity and cognitive load of being an academic and figuring out 10,000 systems for submitting your work hours, filling in forms for your travel.
I don't think that's persuasive. I don't think you're persuading me.
but every workplace, if you're an influencer, you have to really understand cross-platform integration and so on. So it's more like it can be a very useless complexity and cognitive load if the only systems we are using as students and teachers are ones that are unique to the university world. Yes. So we are trained in systems thinking and complexity and managing the learning management system. But then we go out on the other side and we have to use completely new systems. So again, I think that connects to the hybrid thinking of work life, human life, student life, teacher life, that at least how we are doing it a bit less complex these days at our masters are, yes, we have a learning management systems, but that's actually what the word signifies. It's a learning management system. So it's not where teaching goes on. It's for managing. People can go and find the stuff they need to find, right? Mm-hmm. But then teaching and learning goes on with technologies that are disciplinary or relevant or have an impact or have a meaning outside of the learning management system. So for example, the master's in ICT-based educational design I'm teaching, we are thinking about what are the technologies and systems that are relevant for them, either in a critical way, Google, for example, so we have people, public schools using Google in Denmark, learning management systems as a thing because it's this education and so on and so forth. But then when I teach digital design, is digital design tools and platforms, Miro, Jamboards, whatever apps create apps and so on and so forth. So again, it really speaks to the repertoire and starting to think about these technologies as something having a disciplinary value, having a professional value, and having a pedagogical value. Are the tools working for us? So one time when we had another learning management system, it didn't really work for what we were trying to do in this hybrid thing. So I put a link that said, we are here, colon, and then a link in the learning management system. And that was all I put in the learning management system. Then sometimes it changed because we were different places, but it's a bit like putting a sticker on your door and say, find me in the garden or something like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sorry, I just I wasn't sure about our repertoire as learning bureaucratic systems in the university sort of fills me with revolt, if that makes sense, to come to that point. I think it's a really good point. And I think I think someone has left, look, I'm going to close now. Someone has left a beautiful comment in the chat. Sorry, I have to leave. Thank you so much for an engaging talk and helping us to dream a different future. And that is, I think throwing the doors open to possibility is just such a wonderful thing to do. And I mean, all the way through the chat and the questions, people have expressed that this talk has brought that possibility. So thank you so much. I look forward to talking some more. And I really think that you've inspired the many participants we've had and hopefully those who will go on and come to the materials later. So thanks again, Reke, and thanks to everyone else, and thanks for sticking with us to the end.
Thank you so much. And thank you, everyone that listened in.